well. All right, Acts chapter 20. You know, let's see. I think I'm going to read here in just a little bit. All right. You know, I love bread, and apparently I'm not the only one in the world who loves bread. Love of bread is universal. It's probably the one food that is eaten by people of every race, every culture, every religion. Bread has been around for centuries, probably almost since the beginning of man. Experts believe that the first grinding stone was invented by the Egyptians around 8,000 BC. The first breads were flat breads. They were baked from these crushed grains. But later it was discovered that by adding yeast, the bread rises and gets all that much more yummy. Bread was even used in Egypt as a form of currency. You know, every year in America, each of us consumes, on average, 53 pounds of bread. Do you know why God made bread? Why did God make bread? Well, if your answer is for food, well, you wouldn't be wrong, but I also don't think you'd be completely right. Bread is more than something to eat, right? It is a staple. It's eaten so routinely and in such amounts that it is a dominant portion of almost every diet of every person in the world. And so, yes, God made bread to be a staple for all people everywhere so that he could then illustrate an even more vital and significant truth. Right? This truth was first made by God to Israel in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. And then it was reiterated by Jesus as a way by which he resisted the devil's temptation in the wilderness. And the tempter came and said to Jesus, "If you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread." But he answered and said, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." Bread sustains us physically today. But God's word benefits us spiritually forever. And Jesus, the living word, the bread from heaven, said, "I am the bread of life. And he who comes to me will not hunger. He who believes in me will never thirst." The Lord has actually made this point a few times. In his defense, Job declared how important God's words to him, saying, "I've not departed from the command of his lips. I've treasured the words of his mouth more than my necessary food." Similarly, Jeremiah said, "Your words were found, and I ate them. And your words became for me a joy and a delight of my heart." See, there is one food that is essential to our souls, the word of God. It is essential for our knowledge of God and truth, for our growth in grace and discernment, for the building of faith, for the deepening of love. Without it, we cannot know God, love God, or live for God. And from the example that Paul gives us in our passage today, we will see another way God's word is essential to our lives. God's word is essential for our encouragement, and therefore it must be preached, practiced, reproduced, and pursued. God's word is essential for our encouragement, and it must be preached, practiced, reproduced, and pursued. Would you read with me the first 12 verses of chapter 20? And after the uproar had ceased, Paul sent for the disciples. And when he had exhorted them and taken his leave of them, he left them to go to Macedonia. When he had gone through those districts and had given them much exhortation, he came to Greece. And there he spent 3 months. And when a plot was formed against him by the Jews, and he was about to set sail for Syria, he decided to return through Macedonia. And he was accompanied by Sopater of Berea, the son of Pyrrhus, a and by Aristarchus and Secundus of the Thessalonians, and Gaius of Derbe, and Timothy and Tychicus and Trophimus of Asia. But these had gone on ahead and were waiting for us at Troas. We sailed from Philippi after the days of unleavened bread and came to them at Troas within 5 days, and there we stayed 7 days. On the first day of the week, when we were gathered together to break bread, Paul began talking to them, intending to leave the next day, and he prolonged his message until midnight. There were many lamps in the upper room where we were gathered together, and there was a young man named Eutychus sitting on the windowsill, sinking into a deep sleep. And as Paul kept on talking, he was overcome by sleep and fell down from the third floor and was picked up dead. But Paul went down and fell upon him, and after embracing him, he said, "Do not be troubled, for his life is in him." When he had gone back up and had broken the bread and eaten, he talked with them a long while until daybreak and then left. They took away the boy alive and were greatly comforted. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us your word. It guides our steps, for it is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. By reading it, we grow in wisdom. It's like a shield before us that guards our way. It warns us of danger when we are in pain, when we are lonely, when we are afraid. We can run to it for the help we need. When times get tough or we're discouraged, we can find great joy and comfort from you there. When it seems our life has been turned upside down, the peace that we need, it's there for us in your word. And without your word, I would not know you. I could never find you. All the encouragement that we need to persevere in hope, it's available to us in your word. Thank you for sending your son, the living word, who not only spoke words of life, but gave up his life so that we might have the gift of eternal life through faith in him. And Spirit of God, increase our love for your word so that we would be a people who prioritizes its preaching, practices it, reproduces it in others, and pursues growth by it. And we ask this, Lord, in your Son's name and for his glory. Amen. So coming right out of the previous chapter, Luke says, after the uproar had ceased, he's referring, of course, to the riot that had occurred in the city of Ephesus over the impact of Paul's preaching. So many people had been transformed by the gospel that it had impacted the city's main source of income, the worship of Artemis. Those who made their living off of the tourist trade, they were upset that so many people had come to believe, the same as Paul, that gods made without hands are no gods at all. Excuse me, with hands. I said without. Gods made with hands are no gods at all. So the riot was eventually dispelled, and then life in Ephesus was beginning to return to normal. Demetrius, who we met last week, the silversmith who'd helped incite the crowds, may have been pleased to hear that Paul was no longer renting the hall of Tyrannus to spread his lies about the great Artemis of the Ephesians. We learned in the last chapter that Paul had purposed in the Spirit to go to Jerusalem, after which then he set his sights, he says, on Rome. He'd been about to leave for Jerusalem when the riot broke out. And now that order had been restored to the city, Paul's concerns for the church's spiritual well-being were such that he felt he could now leave. Leaving didn't mean, though, that Paul still didn't have his concerns. There was the possibility of further riots, but perhaps the chief concern on his mind was the rise of false teachers that would come after him. And as we'll see next week, Paul will have a second opportunity to meet with these leaders of the church in Ephesus, and he's going to then warn them. It's down in verse 29, that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock, and from among your own selves will arise Men will arise speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after them. What these believers in Ephesus need most is to be encouraged with the truth about God's word, to be exhorted to be faithful. And so Paul sent for the disciples, it says, and he exhorted them. He did this one last time before taking his leave to begin his journey to Jerusalem. And so from Ephesus, he probably journeyed by land north up to Troas, where he then boarded a ship bound, but not for Jerusalem, but for Macedonia, which was somewhat in the opposite direction. And his reason for the detour was to collect funds from the Gentile churches in Macedonia. This would be churches in Philippi, Thessalonica, and Berea, because his plans were to bring these funds back with him to Jewish believers in Jerusalem who were facing very difficult circumstances, as we'll talk a little bit more about here shortly. But as we see, Paul did more than just stop by these churches to collect the financial gifts. Verse 2 says that Paul traveled through these districts and gave them much exhortation. And the word for exhortation is the word in the Greek, parakaleo. It can also be translated encouragement, comfort. And that's exactly how the same word is translated down in verse 12, comforted. So this is the word that the scriptures use to describe the ministry of the Holy Spirit. In John chapter 14, Jesus calls the Holy Spirit the Paraclete, which is translated another helper in the New American Standard. In the ESV, comforter. Oh, no, New American and the ESV are another helper. It's comforter in the King James. It's advocate in the NET, right? The Spirit's ministry is to encourage. It's to impart strength. It's to help those who need it. And the reason that Jesus calls the Spirit another helper is because he would encourage them in the same way that Jesus had encouraged them. And in this sense, Paul's ministry was in the same manner as both the Spirit of God and the Son of God. It was a ministry of the Word of God. What is it that imparts strength and encouragement to God's people? It's a ministry of the Word of God. It's a ministry that focuses on what God had done in saving them by sending His Son as a substitute and a satisfaction for sin. It was a ministry that reminded them of God's covenant promises that cannot be undone, sealed in the blood of Jesus Christ. In other words, Paul preached the gospel to them. That's what he did. But you're thinking, wait, why would he preach the gospel to those who were already believers? Because believers need to be reminded over and over and over of how Christ's death atoned for their sins. But not only that, that Christ has risen from the dead. He sits with all authority at the Father's right hand, and he's building his church. And he's one day he's going to return in power and in glory. And this is the only ministry that encourages, that imparts strength to those who are facing opposition of the world and the flesh and the devil. And so in order to strengthen these young churches, Paul gave each of these churches the same thing that he gave to the leaders of the Ephesians, much exhortation. Now, we may not be a young church in the first century, but we are just as much in need of being strengthened by God's word. Therefore, we take the preaching of God's word, we make it a priority in this church. And because God's word is essential for your encouragement, you must prioritize the preaching of God's word. Prioritize the preaching of God's word, Christian. Perhaps the single most important aspect of the church's life and its ongoing spiritual health is the preaching of God's word. But not just any kind of preaching. No, the pattern of preaching should be primarily expositional as opposed to topical. What's the difference between an expositional and a topical sermon? Well, topical sermons begin with a subject that the preacher wants to preach about, such as prayer, or the character of God, or finances, or marriage. And the preacher then, he gathers various verses together, along with illustrations and applications, to produce a sermon or a series of sermons around that topic, around that theme. Now, there's nothing inherently wrong with preaching a topical sermon. In fact, not too long ago, we preached a series of sermons around the theme of the importance of the church. Right? So based on the feedback that we received from you, God used it in many ways to bless the church. So we're certainly glad for that. But my point is that we chose that topic. We felt it was needful. God blessed it, but we chose it. We chose the topics. We chose the verses to teach those topics. We largely knew what we wanted to say, and then we went to Scripture to find those verses. It was biblical. It was truth. It was needful. It was good. But we chose the topic. To preach that series, we pushed the pause button on preaching through the entire book of Acts. Right? We stopped after chapter 17, and then we resumed about 3 months later with chapter 18. And now we're in chapter 20. I'm sure I don't have to say this because I know you probably all are keeping track, but this month marks 2 years that we've been in the book of Acts. You're all going, I know that. Has it been 2 years? Is it going to be 2 more years? I'm actually quite surprised that it's been 2 years because it does not seem that long to me. But in that time, in this 2 years, just listen to some of the topics that we've covered. Christ's powerful presence. The church God blesses. The meaning of Pentecost, the ministry of deacons, God's purpose for persecution, God's sovereign, indispensable Spirit, ministering effectively for Christ, conflict in the sovereignty of God, where faith comes from, preaching Christ in a post-Christian world, the transforming power of the gospel, just to name a few. And guess who chose those topics? God chose those topics because he inspired the book. I simply unfolded it for you a section at a time. And the reason why preaching must be expositional is because we believe in the authority of Scripture. We believe the Bible is the Word of God. And a commitment to expositional preaching is a commitment to both hear and submit to God's Word. All of it, not just the parts that we choose. As each week comes, you hear the message of Acts unfolded in its context. You knew what happened last week. If you were here last week when I began after the uproar, you knew what the uproar was. The riot in Ephesus. So you're hearing the book of Acts unfold in its context. You see the meaning and the applications rising right out of the text as we preach through it. And God surprises us sometimes with what he says to us. We're challenged, though, week after week to submit to what he says, to be doers of the word. And the end result is that we are being molded and shaped, not by my mind, not by the topics I choose, but by God's mind and by his words. And that's really what we want, isn't it? We want to be molded and shaped by what God has said. By his truth. Do you want faith that is strong and growing and reflected in the decisions that you make in your life? Right? Then you need a regular diet of hearing the Word of God, because faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the Word of Christ. I know I want that for me. I need my faith to be strengthened and challenged and to grow. And I know I want that for you. And for that reason, we make the expositional preaching of the Word of God a priority. Have you made it a priority to be here every week? To be where you can hear the preaching of God's word and the Spirit of God working through that preaching in your life. And the way that God encourages and strengthens you to live for Him uncompromised is you prioritize the preaching of God's word. And so Paul's destination is Jerusalem. But when he leaves Ephesus, he goes up to Macedonia in the opposite direction, traveling through different districts and encouraging the churches that are planted there as a result of his previous journeys. And as I mentioned, his purpose in going there, it was to take up a collection for the poor believers who were in Jerusalem. We know this because of the letters that Paul wrote right around this time. 1 and 2 Corinthians and Romans were all written right around this time. And here's what Paul wrote in his first letter to the Corinthians, written probably just before he left Ephesus. He says this in 1 Corinthians 16. He says, "Now concerning the collection for the saints, as I directed the churches of Galatia, so do you also. On the first day of every week, each one of you is to put aside and save as he prosper, so that no collections be made when I come. When I arrive, whomever you may approve, I will send them with letters to carry your gift to Jerusalem, and if it is fitting for me to go also, they will go with me." So while he's in Macedonia, Paul meets up with Titus, his longtime companion, who has returned from Corinth. Paul then turns around and he writes 2 Corinthians, and in that letter he devotes two chapters, as we have it laid out, chapters 8 and 9, to the collection. Eventually, verse 2 says Paul makes his way down to Greece. And so now he's down in Greece, and by Greece, primarily this is Corinth. And he stays there for 3 months over the winter, during which he writes his magnum opus, the Epistle to the Romans. And near the end of that letter, Paul again mentions the collection. In Romans 15, verse 25, "I'm going to Jerusalem serving the saints. For Macedonia and Achaia have been pleased to make a contribution for the poor among the saints in Jerusalem. Yes, they were pleased to do so, and they're indebted to them. For if the Gentiles have shared in their spiritual things, they are indebted to minister to them also in material things. Therefore, when I have finished this and have put my seal on this fruit of theirs, I will go on by way of you to Spain." Why was this collection so important to Paul that before heading to Jerusalem, he wants to go out there through Macedonia for months to collect this relief fund? Well, certainly Paul cared very much about his Jewish brethren who he knew were suffering, and he desired what he could do to do what he could to help them. The Apostle John probably best captures what Paul's motivation here is in 1 John chapter 3, verse 17, where he says, "But whoever has the world's goods and sees his brother in need and closes his heart against him, how does the love of God abide in him? Little children, let us not love with word or with tongue, but in deed and truth." You know, love for God, it leads to giving to help those who are in need. So loving and giving are inseparable. But hand in hand with helping is an opportunity to promote something that was especially dear to the heart of the Lord, that of unity. Shortly before he was arrested, taken away to be crucified, Jesus prayed for unity among his disciples, including those who would someday come to believe in him. That includes us. Here's how he prayed for them and for us: "That they may all be one, even as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you sent me." That the world may believe that you sent me. Unity and oneness of his people was so important to Jesus that he tied his reputation to it. "If my people are united, the world will know that you sent me." That's what Jesus is saying. Unity was important to Christ, therefore it was important to Paul. And the cultural tensions between Jews and Gentiles, it could easily keep the young church separate. And what a witness of Christ it would be to the world if the church was the one place where Jews and Gentiles were one. This collection was a way for the Gentile Christians to demonstrate their love for their Jewish brothers and to promote unity amongst disciples. You know, it's not enough that we prioritize the preaching of God's word. We must also practice the doing of God's word. Practice the doing of God's word. We can say the Bible is God's authoritative word, but talk is cheap. What matters is that we demonstrate its authority over us by submitting to it, by being doers of it. Paul knew that Jesus, the living Word of God, desired unity among his people, and so he went to great effort to promote it through this gift. And in addition, those who have greatly desired to show their love for the saints, they're doing so through their giving. In 2 Corinthians 8, Paul says, "Now, brethren, we wish to make known to you the grace of God which has been given in the churches of Macedonia, that in a greater deal of affliction, their abundance of joy and their deep poverty overflowed in the wealth of their liberality. For I testify that according to their ability and beyond their ability, they gave of their own accord, begging us with much urging for the favor of participation in the support of the saints. And this, not as we had expected, but they first gave themselves to the Lord and to us by the will of God." See, these churches in Macedonia, these Christians, they did more than just pray. They gave, and they gave liberally. They wanted to be the kind of people that James speaks about, who are doers of the word and not merely hearers who delude themselves. They wanted to live out the preaching that they heard. Right? Is that your desire? Or are you more a hearer of the word and not a doer? But such a person, James says, is like a man who looks at his natural face in the mirror. And for once he's looked at himself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of a person he was. That's not a good way to be. That's more than just Alzheimer's. That's a spiritual problem. That's a heart problem. Right? He's saying, you know what you need to do? As you sit here and as you hear the Word of God being preached and the Spirit of God is pricking you on different things that need to be put into practice or turned away from. He's saying, you know what? You need to be diligent. You need to be quick about putting what you hear preached into practice in your life. God wants to use you. He wants to use you, Christian. He wants to bless others through you, but you have to act on what you hear, lest you forget the things that God shows you about yourself, like this man who looks in the mirror and can't remember what he looks like. Doesn't do you any good to sit here and go, you know what, I need to do something about that, and then walk out of here and not do it. That does you no good. Does others no good. Makes the devil pretty happy. Grieves the Spirit of God. We need to practice the doing of God's word. So Paul spends 3 months now in Corinth, probably waiting out the winter months there while the weather is too dangerous to travel by sea to Jerusalem. And for some reason, Luke chooses really not to give us any details about Paul's time in Corinth. He doesn't even mention that he's in Corinth. He just says he's in Greece. And not sure why, perhaps to keep us focused on Paul's overall goal of getting back to Jerusalem. Because that's where it's going to head. It's going to go from Jerusalem on to Rome, right? And that's really the focus from here to the end of the book of Acts. But given the nature of the church in Corinth, I'm sure Paul was pretty busy there with a multitude of pastoral problems, and he was probably busy on a daily basis. And in the midst of writing the book of Romans, Paul also manages to be the target of a plot by the Jews to kill him. And it would appear that he was made aware of it just about the time that he was about to board the ship that was going to take him to Jerusalem by way of Syria. Verse 3 says, when a plot was formed against him by the Jews and he was about to set sail for Syria, he decided to return through Macedonia by land, not by sea. Next, we're introduced to Paul's posse here. Seven co-workers in the gospel who are traveling with him. The people who are here, Sopater, son of Pyrrhus of Berea. Then there was Aristarchus and Gaius. Aristarchus is called a fellow prisoner in Colossians 4:10. We're told in Acts 27, a few chapters down the road, that he was a Macedonian from Thessalonica who'd been with Paul in Ephesus, and along with Gaius, he was dragged into the amphitheater by the mob during the riot. Aristarchus joined the Apostle Paul on his final journey from Judea to Italy, along with Luke. That's all in Acts chapter 27. Finally, there's Secundus from Thessalonica, Paul's longtime friend and constant companion Timothy, and along with him two others from Asia, Trophimus and Tychicus, who will later carry, along with Onesimus, Paul's letter to the Colossians and to the Ephesians. So these were all men that Paul had ministered to, shared the gospel with, they'd come to faith in Christ, and now they're going to be used in varying ways moving forward as the church continues to grow and expand. But right now, they're all gathered together. Trophimus is a Gentile. Actually, Trophimus is the Gentile that the Jews, when Paul gets to Jerusalem, he's going to get in trouble with the Jews again. And it's because a rumor that was started that Trophimus was brought by Paul into the forbidden areas of the temple, and that got him all riled up. And so we have Timothy from Lystra, Aristarchus and Secundus from Thessalonica, Tychicus from Asia, Sopater from Berea, Trophimus from Ephesus, Gaius from Derbe, and both Titus and Luke were from Antioch. That's quite a spread around the area. This is a very diverse group, but it's a group that is united by the gospel shared to them by Paul. These men represent Paul's success from a wide-ranging mission among the Gentiles. They're also likely the, the official representatives of the churches who had given relief funds for the believers in Jerusalem. They're accompanying Paul. But these are men into whom Paul has invested. They are men who, for the most part, they're going to continue the ministry that Paul began. Jesus had invested into 12 men whose teachings would become the foundation for the church. He then commanded those men to make disciples of all nations. These men were some of the fruit of their obedience to Christ's command. These are the men who will continue to preach and make disciples after Paul is gone. Now, as a church, God wants us to look beyond where we are right now. Because God's word is essential for the encouragement of God's people, He wants us to be preparing the next generation of teachers today. And this is why one of our priorities as a church is to reproduce teachers of God's word. Reproduce teachers of God's word. Paul, the one who trained up these men, he told Timothy who he should invest into. He tells him this in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2. He says, the things which you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. God's primary criteria for a teacher begins not with giftedness. It begins with faithfulness. You know, when I was 10 years old, my father was stationed at Peterson Air Force Base in Colorado Springs, Colorado, which also happens to be the location of the Air Force Academy. I remember staring up at the words that are affixed above the warrior ramp, as it's called. Bring me men. Came from a poem by Samuel Walter Foss, recognizing the need of men of character and courage, and determination, and vision, who are willing and worthy to build a nation. It's a fitting slogan for an institution that is designed to train up the future leaders and protectors of a nation. That slogan, by the way, it remained until the pressure of political correctness forced it to change into something reflecting integrity and service and excellence. So it no longer says, "Bring me men." It says something else. But Paul is essentially saying the same thing here. He's not just saying, "Bring me men." He's saying, "Bring me faithful men. Bring me faithful men." And this term men, I have to say it today. It's inclusive of men and women. Used to be fine to say men to mean men and women, but we have to say that now so nobody gets offended. It means men and women. The faithful man, the faithful woman is one with proven spiritual character whose desire to follow and obey Christ is clearly evident by their choices, by their priorities, by their pursuits. Right? These are the people in the church that God will use greatly for His glory because they love Christ, because they love His Word. These are the people, God says, that can be entrusted with the responsibility of teaching God's truth to another generation. This process of spiritual reproduction, which began here in the early church, it's to continue on until Christ returns. Faithfulness, it begins with an unwavering desire to know Christ and what it means to follow Him. Right? It begins with discipleship. Faithful disciples of Christ, they seek to make more disciples of Christ through the sharing of the gospel, through the sharing of their faith, through the sharing of their lives. And from those who are faithful to the task of making disciples, there will be those whom God has gifted to teach. These are the ones that God says to invest further effort into, to train them up to teach in the church. Those who will teach in the church, they're not any more loved by God than those who serve faithfully in other ways. But they are entrusted with a great responsibility to which God will hold them accountable. Teachers must be disciplined to devote the time and the effort to study the Word, to prepare lessons. Those who teach must be mature enough not to let their God-given abilities go to their heads. To be discerning. To know how to speak the truth in love. Our job as leaders is to recognize who God is raising up to teach His truths to the next generation. And the first thing God says to look for, it's not giftedness. It's faithfulness. That's where it begins. Reproducing teachers of God's Word, then, it begins with discipleship, following Jesus and serving His people faithfully. So these nine men, they made their way north to Philippi, where they were joined by Luke. And Luke doesn't mention his name. You look there, I don't see Luke's name there. The way we know it is because in verse 6, he says, "We sailed from Philippi." Luke's with him now. He's including himself. So the majority of the group sailed ahead to Troas in Asia, while at least Paul and Luke remained in Philippi. So that he's gone north now from Corinth up north to Philippi. Most of the group goes over across the Aegean back to Troas. Paul and at least Luke remain in Philippi, it says, until after the days of unleavened bread. So once Passover had passed, Paul and Luke sailed from Philippi to Troas, where they would spend a week with these other men who had gone on ahead, all the men that we named earlier. So we should pause briefly to notice something significant that Luke says just in passing in verse 7. On the first day of the week, when we were gathered together to break bread. Right? The first day of the week. This is the earliest recording. The earliest recorded instance that Christians now met together for corporate worship on the first day of the week, not the last day of the week, which would be Saturday. So they were now meeting on Sundays. And this change of the Sabbath from the seventh day, Saturday, to the first day, Sunday, it was a response to that of being the day of the week when Jesus rose from the dead. They saw the day as commemorating Christ's resurrection, signaling the end of the old, beginning of the new. Old things had passed away, and eventually it became known as the Lord's Day. We meet on the Lord's Day, essentially by tradition, not by command. We could meet on Saturday. We could meet on Tuesday. We choose to meet on Sunday in the tradition of the church. It's not commanded, though. That's what we choose to do. Luke says that they gathered together to break bread. Paul began talking to them. So their worship service was primarily preaching and teaching from the Scriptures and then a celebration of the Lord's Supper. Maybe a hymn or two thrown in there. So this occasion was certainly unusual in that in one location, Troas, were the representatives from the churches of Macedonia. And in addition, the Apostle Paul was there too. This is perhaps one of the earliest pastors' conferences that has ever occurred. Now, unlike today, Sunday was just another working day, which meant that that church for Christians at this time, it was either held early in the morning on Sunday or late in the evening after the workday was done, or both. You know, they didn't have five-day work weeks, and Sunday was not the day that folks stayed home to watch football. Now, interestingly, up until about the last generation, there used to be laws restricting or banning some of all Sunday activities in order to promote the observance of worship or a day of rest. They were called blue laws or Sunday laws. And they often restricted shopping or the sale of things like alcohol or cars on a Sunday. Most of them have been repealed, but believe it or not, not all of them have been. There's some that still exist, like in Bergen County, New Jersey, where the people there in that county, they still vote to ban the sale of clothing, shoes, furniture, home supplies, and appliances on Sundays. You want to buy any of those things on a Sunday, you got to go outside Bergen County and buy them there. There is one last vestige of blue laws that I would be happy to go away. It frustrates me every now and then. Chick-fil-A. How many times after church have you thought, hey, let's go to Chick-fil-A? They're closed. So gathered together in Troas, we have leaders from the churches of Macedonia along with the Apostle Paul. So this is a unique opportunity for all of them from these different churches, different locations, to worship the Lord together and to be encouraged together in the Scriptures. Now, it should be no surprise then that the sermon on this occasion was a lengthy one. We're not told what time the sermon began, but given that in a community without electricity, the daily ritual was to get your start early in the day as the sun rose and go to bed not long after it set. And so it was likely early evening or at least after the normal workday had ceased that they gathered. This meant that those from Troas who had attended this gathering had been working since sun up. And one of those attending was a young man named Eutychus. Now, if you know the story of Eutychus, which we did read, here's what you'll find. Many popular interpretations of this episode, they depict Paul starting his sermon at a fairly typical hour, let's say around 6 or 7 in the evening. Paul really gets going. He gets his second wind around 11 p.m., midnight comes, Paul's still going strong, but it's just a little bit too much for this young man, Eutychus, who, overcome with a mixture of boredom and fatigue, finally loses his battle with sleep. The window seat that he'd been so happy to have earlier in the night now becomes a living nightmare. He falls out of the window, two stories down, to his death. Eutychus was literally preached to death. No worries, though, because the Apostle Paul is on the scene. He rushes down. He miraculously brings the poor guy back to life and then, undeterred, goes back upstairs and continues preaching until dawn. Yes. Right, apparently even the great apostle is capable of preaching a sermon that is too long and boring. We preachers, we need to be more sensitive to our congregation enough to maintain your attention, which sometimes means we have to do dances and tell silly stories and things like that. The congregation should also care enough about the truth not to fall asleep while it's being presented, lest you fall out of your chairs and break your wrist. And I don't have the ability to heal that. But is that what's actually happening here? Is that what's actually happening here? I don't think so. Let's read it again. Verses 7 to 12. On the first day of the week, when we were gathered together to break bread, Paul began talking to them, intending to leave the next day, and he prolonged his message until midnight. There were many lamps in the upper room where we were gathered together, and there was a young man named Eutychus sitting on the windowsill, sinking into a deep sleep. And as Paul kept on talking, he was overcome by sleep and fell down from the third floor and was picked up dead. But Paul went down and fell upon him, and after embracing him, he said, "Do not be troubled, for his life is in him." And when he had gone back up and had broken the bread and eaten, he talked with them a long while until daybreak and then left. They took away the boy alive and were greatly comforted. And that word there for comforted? Encouraged. Parakaleo, same one as exhortation up above. The book ends on this two-story. Encouraged. Encouraged by the preaching of the word. This is God's essential encouraging word. We're seeing how it's played such a key role in this episode here in the Apostle Paul's travels. You know, Sunday has become the normal day for the church to gather together for worship. But this gathering that we've talked about here, this is not a normal gathering of the saints. Not only are there leaders from other churches, but they also have the privilege of having Paul, the great servant of the Lord, right there in their midst. And they want to make sure to give him all the time he wants to preach from the scriptures. Why? Because it's going to encourage them. They're going to be greatly comforted by what they hear. It's certainly clear that Paul does preach for a long time, but we're not told exactly when he began, which might help us to understand what's going on. What we might have here, what I think we have here, is a congregation of believers from various backgrounds gathering as opportunity provides. Several sources indicate that Eutychus was a fairly common name for slaves. If this were the case, then we might suggest that Eutychus, together with several others of the same or even of different circumstances here in Troas, has made his way to worship once his day's work is done. And it's probably late in the night. But he very well could have attended early that morning, because that's when the church might have gathered also. And this was a special time. So because they gathered in the morning, guys, come back tonight. The Apostle Paul's going to be here. So they made every effort to gather again, even though it was later in the night and they'd worked all day long. Now, if this is the case, then what we have here is a slightly more favorable portrait of Paul and of Eutychus. See, on the one hand, this is not Paul preaching a long and dull sermon without regard for the capacity of his hearers. On the other hand, this is not dopey Eutychus who simply can't sustain his interest or who's too young or too weak to keep up with the pace of the sermon. What we have here probably is a group of committed and eager believers who are seizing a great opportunity to hear the word of God from an amazing servant of the Lord, the Apostle Paul, before he moves on and never returns to this part of the land again. So they set the time to gather at the end of the working day when even the slaves are free from their duties. They come weary, but they come eager. They light the lamps to keep the room lit so they're enabled to make the most of their brief time together. Yes, they're tired. Both the preachers and the hearers are tired. But this is such a unique and rich opportunity that they're eager to make the most of it. So far from criticizing Paul for preaching too long or pitying poor Eutychus for being subjected to such an ordeal, we ought to be commending these men for their appetite for fellowship, for God, and for his people. Yes, young Eutychus does eventually succumb to fatigue. He falls down from two stories high. But notice that once he's restored, it's not as if everyone decides, oh, well, gosh, we better call it a night, huh? No. Not even then. They knew God's word was essential for their encouragement in the faith. And so they remained until dawn to get all the encouragement that they could milk from the Apostle Paul. Now, I wonder if we're as eager to grow in our faith as these Christians were. We need to pursue growing in God's word. It has to be a pursuit. It's not going to happen unless you pursue it. You can sleep on your Bible and none of it's going to get into you. You've got to pursue it. How eager are we to meet with God, with his people on the appointed day to hear the truth explained, proclaimed, applied? How determined are we to make the most of our opportunities for worship? Are we ready to swap shifts? Are we ready to make up hours just so that we can meet with the saints on Sunday? And if necessary, either because of persecution or some other necessity, would you be willing to meet before dawn? Would you be willing to meet after dusk just to worship the Lord your God together with his people? Or is that just a little bit too much to ask? See, I think we have a good example here in Eutychus. I think he was in the right place at the right time with the right people doing the right thing. He was pursuing growth in God's word. God's desire for you, Christian, is that you grow up, you mature, and you deepen your faith in Christ. Paul's desire for the Ephesians was that they grow up in all aspects into him who is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body, being fitted and held together by what every joint supplies. God is the one who causes the growth. But he does it in conjunction with your pursuit after growth. We should all want to grow spiritually. Peter emphasizes the importance of knowing God's word. If you want to grow, he says, this is what you need to do. Like newborn babies, long for the pure milk of the word, so that by it you may grow in respect to salvation, if you have tasted the kindness of the Lord. See, God wants you to be taking in his word as routinely as you eat bread. Gluten-freeers, you get my meaning. God's word is essential for our encouragement, and it must be preached, it must be practiced, it must be reproduced, and it must be pursued. Amen? Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we know the importance of your word, maybe to varying degrees, but we know it needs to be central to our lives, and we know we face resistance from our own flesh every day to be in it. But God, you have broken the power of sin in us. We just need to overcome our own resistance. We need to discipline ourselves for the purpose of godliness if we desire to grow. We can't complain about our lack of growth when we won't be in your word or in prayer. You've given us everything pertaining to life and godliness in your word. Let us pursue knowing it, meditating upon it, doing it, prioritizing the preaching of it. Let us do all these things because we know the result will be that which brings glory to you and satisfaction and joy to our lives. Help us to overcome the resistance that's in our own hearts, God. Help us to overcome that. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand.